Here's the, so here's the structure that you typically have at a server, especially if you set it up correctly. You have people down here with their browser logging in and filling in credit card numbers and hitting the buy button and stuff. That goes up to the web server, and that's all they can talk to directly. And over here, you have the data stored in a database server, which the people on the internet cannot access directly at all. They don't, this talks only to the web server, and this talks to the clients, so it forms a security barrier. So this is the thing that might get hacked, but they'll have to go through another attack to get over here, because this has all your secrets, like passwords and account numbers and credit card numbers and everything. So you talk to the server with HTTP, and it then uses the CGI scripts to send data over to the database, request for data, and it sends data records back, and that's how it decides whether you've logged in and records that you submitted payment details and you want to buy something. And the technology that goes across is ODBC or these other ones, which is just a way of packaging data to move over a network back and forth. Yeah.
Now, can't you have different types of attacks and different, like, SQL injection over here and then input validation over here, or what?
Well, there are different kinds of attack. Cross-site scripting would exploit it just here. SQL injection will trick this into sending something dangerous over here and get the data from the database. But cross-site scripting is a more shallow attack that just affects what people see on the screen and doesn't steal the data from the server. That's why people don't take it so seriously. But SQL injection is really bad because they're stealing data out of your database, and that's usually confidential stuff. So, yeah, anyway, so you connect to the database, and the technology you use to go across, there's a variety of them. The original one is Open Database Connectivity, ODBC, and then there are various later ones that all do essentially the same thing. They just have some way of structuring data so you can move it across a network. You can send a request of some sort to the database, like, is this guy with this name and password in the database? If so, give me his profile, and so on. It's just a way to send that data back across. These are later versions of technology to do essentially the same thing. So the point is, your applications have vulnerabilities, and that's as important as, say, network security. Simply things like protecting yourself against DOS attacks and maintaining proper TCP sessions and such. If someone can take over the web server, they can, of course, deface the website, they can destroy or steal your data, perform secondary attacks from your website, which is extremely common. My sister just contacted me. The PHP files are appearing in my GoDaddy. I read them. It was actually very clever. I'm probably going to write up a blog post and show it to my 129S class. They got a nice clean PHP server which listens to parameters, and you can use it to do a bunch of things. You can send spam email from our server, you can redirect traffic from our server from search engines to go somewhere else. It has a nice multi-purpose clean little PHP file that lets you abuse this her server, and all the time the normal service will continue and most people will never know what happened. So it's they're getting pretty good at that. I've been following that for several years. A lot of colleges are infected with these PHP redirectors where they hide on the server and use it for an evil purpose without you noticing, so you just continue to use it for year after year, being unaware that you're owned. And that's why I think like the CCDC contest, Collegiate Cyber Defense Competition, is actually very realistic. In this competition, you come in and you have like a network of servers, like client servers and email servers and web servers doing something, and it's already owned. Bad guys already have shells on it and they're using it for evil purposes, and you're supposed to run the business anyway. And you're supposed to like keep on servicing your customers, to keep asking you for new web pages and stuff, and try to kick out the bad guys. But that is the real way it is done at businesses now. Many people are using servers, and the bad guys are using it too, at the same time, and you just cope with it. Anyway, so OWASP, I mentioned before, these guys do a whole lot of things. They publish code, they have meetings, they're really active in the South Bay. Down near Stanford, the OWASP meetings are very nice. I've been to a few of them. And so here's the top 10 web application vulnerabilities. Number one is always command injection. Command injection is the most dangerous vulnerability in the world. If you only know one thing about security, that should be it. It's used to steal more than 95% of all the data that's ever been stolen because it's extremely powerful, quite common, and extremely easy to perform. You don't have to use any complicated tools to exploit command injection, and the most common type that's used is SQL injection, but there are other kinds of command injection too. Cross-site scripting is extremely common, more common than command injection flaws, but much less dangerous. It doesn't let you steal data from the database, it just lets you add script to what other people see. Then there's malicious file execution, where you're somehow able to upload and run a malicious file. The most common one I see here is the one I was talking about, PHP redirectors. Your PHP page has some way to put data up, and it can somehow be abused to put up a malicious PHP file and run it up there. Unsecured direct object reference is also quite common. I've seen this in browsers. where you go to the administration page and it says, please log in with the administrator password. And when you log in, it redirects you to page like admin.html. Well, if you put that in your bookmarks and just go directly to admin.html, you have the administration page without logging in first. It's not actually protected by a proper session management and permission model. It's just protected through obscurity. They think you won't know the URL. This is what they call security through obscurity. It's like hiding the key under the mat. There's a secret that they think you won't notice, and if you find out the secret, then the security's gone. Anyway, cross-site request forgery is where you cause a script to execute in the wrong context, and the most common form is you steal a cookie. You steal somebody's cookie on your machine, and I put it on my machine and use the same cookie, and the server is so sloppily written that it doesn't detect that I'm on the wrong machine. And so I'm able to use your cookie to get in your account. Now, there's no need for that. The cookie could include code that records your IP address or something else about that machine, so if I put it on another machine, it won't work. But that, if you don't put that in, which is anti-cross-site request forgery tokens, then this works, and most websites are vulnerable to this, more than half. You can do it with, there are specialized tools like Hamster and Ferret, but in Project Share, you just do it with Wireshark. Just use Wireshark, see this cookie, copy the cookie, run it off to the braces. You could just steal somebody's phone and get the cookies off it. You can just steal it from the coffee house if it's sent unsecure. There was another tool called FireSheep, where you would just open it and go to a coffee house and you'll see everybody's session. This guy's Facebook, this guy's Twitter, this guy's everything, everybody's site, you just click and you're in them, you're there. You can commit 100 felonies in like an hour. There were like a million downloads the first weekend that thing came out. Many people have tried to have theatrical demonstrations of this to try to shame people into improving, and now it's finally getting a little better. Yeah?
So now cookies are encrypted though, right?
If you use HTTPS, that would be a pretty good defense because it'll be encrypted and harder to steal. You can still do it with a man-in-the-middle attack, but it's harder. Yeah, that's right. HTTPS is one defense, but a much better defense is real anti-CSRF tokens. So even if somebody gets your cookie, it will recognize that it has been moved to a different machine and not accepted anymore. That would be a lot better. Then there's information leakage. We were talking about this, earlier. Your error messages might be putting out too much information, like source code and versions of your cryptography libraries and such, or your login page. Your password, forgot my password page might tell you, oh, the username is recognized, but the password's wrong. This, it seems like it's helping the user, but it's mainly helping the attacker. You find usernames and so on. And another one is a lot of them have broken authentication and session management where the session is not actually recorded in any secure way. I saw that here at the college a while ago. I was at a boring faculty meeting, and the department chair was looking at next semester schedule I wasn't authorized to see, but I noticed that the URL just had question ID equals 17429, so I just typed it in, and suddenly I was authenticated as the department chair viewing the classified stuff. It was just right there in the URL. If you had the URL, you were in. That's another thing you can do. You can take the token that identifies you and just put it in a URL where everybody can see it. It's even sleazier than putting it in a cookie, but it's a lot of people do it and they just don't think about that. And then there's making cryptographic errors. There are a ton of these where you use old versions of cryptography that can be broken. You store the key someplace where it can be stolen. Microsoft did this. I mean, one of the problems with one of Microsoft's encryption protocols, I think it was PPTP, they actually published a secret key in one of their documents. And it is like a bad move. But another guy heard when public key encryption came out, which we'll be talking about in a couple lessons here, you have these two keys. There's a private key and a public key. You tell everybody the public key, and you keep the private key a secret. That's how it works. Well, when the FBI got it, there were FBI agents that put both keys on their business card, the public key and the private key, and said, this is for public information, and that's for private information. Because people do things they just don't understand. And anyway, so this one of the recent ones was kind of big when Kashmir Hill came over here. A bunch of Tor developers set up PGP, so everybody can send them secret confidential information, and then you have to have a fingerprint of your key so people can tell if it's the authentic key or fake key. And they used a fingerprint that was only 32 bits long. So somebody figured out, I can just make another public key that has a collision with the same 32 bits, and I can now make a fake key that matches that signature. And that was hitting the news when she came here, and she was worried, but hers was 64 bits long, which is better. But there are many mistakes like this that people can make, where somehow you are leaking something that means your cryptography can be intruded into. Yeah?
So they made a copy of a public key?
No, they made another account with a different public key that happened to have the same fingerprint, because the fingerprint was too short. Yeah. Anything 32 bits long is not long enough.
You need 64 bits or better, 128 bits, if you want to have a fingerprint that really can't be forged. Yeah?
When people log out of their accounts, what happens to that link? Because it's not saving the history anymore, right?
What ought to happen when you log out is the cookie should be invalidated on the server. So that if someone comes in with that cookie, they can't get in anymore. More than half of the websites I tested, what happens when you log out is they just delete the cookie and it continues to work. So you can't get it anymore, but the attacker that stole it can still get in. And these websites also, most of them have the property that if you go change your password, the old cookie still works. There's nothing you can do at all to stop an attacker who stole your cookie from going in except to cancel your account and make a new account.
So can you go to any other computer on campus and go to the history and then see
Absolutely.
All the sessions?
Yes. And you'll find the cookies in there. Yes. They ought to be time limited, tied to one machine, transmitted over secure connections, but a lot of people don't know this. Then there's security through obscurity, where there are certain URLs that go places that you aren't allowed to go, and instead of having an authentication structure where they know who you are and only let the right person in, they just hope nobody will find the secret URL. So cross-site scripting is one of these big attacks, and let me just show you some fun there. I don't know if I've done this one in this class yet, but if you go to attack, all right, this is the next one, 32-bit, that came by later. Okay, so this one here has got various fun things to play with. I now made it HTTPS because some college security systems were actually freaking out, so I hid it off from them so they'll get less angry. So if you go here and you're gonna log in, I can put in my name is Sam and my password is password. And I log in, and it says I'm rejected. So that's no good. So here it tells you something to try, like root and tor. Root and tor. Now I'm logged in. Now I can put up a comment. So first, let's erase the old comments, because people put all sorts of junk in there. Let's say, hi there. Okay, I post a comment. This is like a cheap Facebook wall. Okay, so Linux root user said hi there. Okay, well, that's fine. But suppose I say not hi there, but then I say italic. This is one of the simplest tests for cross-site scripting. Now when I post that comment, now it changed to italic. Now this means either this is a smart website that allows you to use some formatting tags so you can express yourself, or it's a stupid website that didn't think about you doing this at all. And so the test is now, try putting in a script tag. Script alert one script. And by the way, I'm not quite sure if I need a semicolon or not. So one thing, whenever you're doing this, is always just copy it in the clipboard, because you often have to modify it over and over again to get it work. And now, there we are. Now it's popping up boxes. This is what most people do. This is the end of the world. I now own that box. Because this means I can put arbitrary script and do anything I want to anybody that sees my wall. So there's some fun ones down here. This is the one you typically do to detect the vulnerability. This one's fun. You can redirect them to somewhere else. This is called the document object model. Everything in your browser is part of the document, and there are these terms here that let you refer to each field and each control on the form. So you can change the location, which is this thing up here, the URL bar. I can change that with JavaScript. So I can put this in, and that will move it to ccsf.edu. So I post that comment, and when you view the wall, you see this pop up, and when you say okay, it goes to the wall and suddenly hops over here. Now this was pretty fun when Obama and Hillary were running for president in 2008. Or maybe 2004, but I think it was 2008. And their primary was neck and neck, and they were fighting. So Obama had a message board. He was one of his big things was to be the internet using candidate, where he had a real active Twitter account and everything. And Hillary had one too, wasn't quite as active. So somebody went to the Obama website, and he was using PHPBB, which is very commonly used and very rarely updated and all full of vulnerabilities like almost anything made with PHP. So it had a cross-site scripting flaw. So somebody put a tag like this on the Obama page. So you'd look at the Obama page, you'd see these comments, and suddenly, poof, you're over on the Hillary page. So when it sees that comment, it would jump over there. That's a simple attack with cross-site scripting. Of course, what's much more malicious is to move you to another website. See, most people are logged into several services all day long. One tab is logged into Twitter, one tab is logged into Amazon, another is logged into their Gmail all day long. So I can just open another tab and you can buy my book at Amazon. Click this link, buy, one click buy, and it'll happen if you happen to be logged into Amazon. That's cross-site scripting. Anything that's active on your machine, especially mobile devices, are typically logged into about 10 things all the time because nobody wants to type in the password. So these kind of flaws can be a lot more serious than you think. And Here's another one. This is the one bad guys use a lot when they deface WordPress sites. You might want to add malware to a page. So let's put this here. Post a comment. I still add that one there. That's harmless. So now when you go, oh, I got to get rid of some of my comments. My comments are overwriting each other. Let's clear them out. Okay, and put in this one again. That's why I always want to put it in a clipboard. Okay, so now I have the page and I've added more content from another page in a window. This is like an ad. Now this, unfortunately, is how ads work. That's why the most simple way, if you want to infect a bunch of machines, is to just pay money and buy an ad. You can then serve malware in the ad, because what an ad is just a window that goes to a different server. So put up like an innocent ad, and then after your ad is being displayed, change it to a malware ad. It'll take them a while to figure it out. You'll infect thousands of people before that happens. And if you pay for the ad with a fake account and a stolen credit card number, then they'll never find you, and this happens all the time. And the number one way people get infected is called a watering hole attack. You create a page that your victims are likely to read, and then you put malware on it. Or you inject it on a page they're going to go to. That's why the number one, here's a fun thing, I saw this story about a year ago. What is the most dangerous kind of web surfing you can do? What is like the worst thing you can do? Any guesses? Going to get you infected. Come on, you got to have some ideas. What is it you shouldn't do because you'll get infected if you do that?
Download music.
Download music on BitTorrent. That's dangerous. That's one. What else?
Clicking illegal links.
Yeah, go get stolen software. Where's
don't
yeah?
Stuff.
What's that?
Don't be clicking on anything.
Yeah, click on ads. That would be bad. Another thing that a lot of people say is go to porn sites. These are things that people figure will get infected. That's all wrong. The most dangerous thing you can do is read the current news. Like whatever happened, like if there's like a debate, you want to read about the debate that happened last night, that is the most dangerous thing you can do, because the bad guys have figured this out, and they go to like the Google scraper that tells you what the most popular thing is, and they make pages full of terms about the current events, and they put malware on them, and they make them rise in the search engines, so that when you try to see whatever's exciting right now, it's all full of malware. I mean, and what can you do? You can't quit doing that.
But churches, too, are like one of the highest.
Oh, churches, I think, frequently have malware on them because they tend to be cheap and sleazy, but very few people read the site, so they don't actually infect as many people as current news. But yeah, that's true. But small businesses in general are pretty low in security because they can't have any money to do anything. Yeah?
I think I have the same question, but do you think usually Google, when you search something, it's a bad thing for Google to actually put something malicious in the first?
Very often, they have failed. Google is constantly trying to clean it up, and the whole search engine optimization crowd is constantly trying to push malware sites higher, so it goes back and forth. I remember this happened to my grader about a year ago. She had a problem with her AOL account. Suddenly she didn't log in. The password changed. So she Googled her AOL help, and she got a phone number that came right up in Google, and that was not AOL. She called them, and they gave her control of the computer to fix it, and it wasn't AOL, because the bad guys had figured out how to poison the Google search algorithm to make fake AOL help sites come higher. And Google, about a month later, Google figured that out and changed their algorithm to beat them down again, but it keeps happening. It's very valuable to move yourself up in Google, so the bad guys have an endless series of tricks. And one of the tricks is putting PHP redirector on my sister's site and everybody else's site that caused the Google search bot to be redirected to a different page so they misunderstand what they're looking at. That's one of the big tricks. Anyway, so what you do, you put one of these up on somebody's page, like New York Times or anything, you make it zero size so nobody can see it, and in there is malware. Now people are all getting infected, and they're getting infected from this domain. They'll say, who is this rottensamsclass.info full of malware? You'll start appearing in a blacklist. The search engine won't see you anymore. And you can search your server all day long. There is no malware on your server. But because you have a cross-site scripting vulnerability, somebody can bounce an attack off your server and you get blamed for it. Yeah?
You said that's how they depress WordPress sites?
This is one common trick, because WordPress had a whole series of vulnerabilities. One of them was the Tim Thumb plugin. There's a plugin that lets, or a SQL injection in WordPress, a bunch of these, lets you upload a file, and you upload just an iframe tag that adds to existing pages an invisible thing that adds malware to the page. That's a very common attack. You'll see them come by frequently in the news. Anyway, that's one fun one. And of course, here's the cross-site request forgery one. You can just steal cookies, because this one, I don't know what happened here. I must have forgot to post it. Let's see. Let's erase the old comments and then post the new one. There we are. Now it pops up a cookie. And there's my authorization cookie. See, if it can pop it up, it can send it to a third-party server. I can just send it to a server and harvest it. I can send it off by email or any variety, just an HTTP request will do. This is how you get in people's accounts. If I can get you to click on a link, or if I find a page that has a cross-site scripting vulnerability, I can steal you. There was a company called Phone Factor that was one of the first two-factor authentication companies. And the CEO of Phone Factory, it was this deal where you get, you log in with your password, and then you get an SMS on your phone also. And he thought this was the end of all problems when he invented this. It is great. And he advertised a $10,000 challenge. Nobody can hack me. If anybody hacks me, they'll win $10,000. So within 2 days, he got hacked. But a professional pen tester got in, and what they did was, first they downloaded the product and played with it, that's Recon, and they found out that just like all the other two-factor authentications, like Google two-factor, you don't want to do this all the time, so on your own machine, you click a box that says, don't ask me for the SMS all the time on this machine, just put a cookie on this machine, that means I'm trusted. And they found that out, so then they said, all I have to do is steal the cookie from the CEO's machine. So they sent him an email with a PDF attached that said, we have hacked into you, the PDF concludes the proof. And when he opened the PDF, it took his cookie and sent it off to a remote server. So they got his cookie, put it on their machine. Now they didn't need two factors, they were in. And so they weren't hacked until he read the message, and then he was hacked. But you know, that's why, one lesson, never say that. Never say, nobody can hack me, I dare anybody to hack me. This is not wise. Those guys are pretty sharp. Yeah.
The actual cookie is stored on his machine, and when he goes into like a web browser, the API talks to your API and then verifies the cookie, and then...
That's right. You send the cookie to the server, and the cookie authenticates you, so you're in the account without needing to know the password or getting the SMS. Because you don't want to have to keep logging in. Your machine has to retain the state that it's logged in.
So it's like nowhere on the web except on your computer, but they
it's on your computer and on the server, but if it's not correctly designed, I can steal it and run it in a different context and it will still be accepted. That's the cross-site request forgery. It ought to be fingerprinted, so it will only run on that one machine. And when I try to run it from another machine, it detects that, no, that's a forged cookie. But if they don't think of that, it'll work. Yeah?
What about the incognito mode?
The what?
Incognito mode?
Incognito mode just means your browser will not put anything in the history. And I think it won't retain any cookies when you leave incognito mode. So it prevents people from coming up and use your machine after you from finding the cookies sitting around in the browser. It also, by the way, bypasses paywalls. If you want to read New York Times articles, just go to incognito mode. Because the New York Times stores, I was reading one, New York Times put up their paywall. It puts every article you've ever read in the cookie in plain text and sends it in plain text every time. Every time you visit the New York Times, it broadcasts all the articles you've read this month, the headlines. I thought that was kind of rude. But anyway, if you delete your cookies, you get another 10 articles. If you use incognito mode, you get all the articles you want. And that's because, you know, they're not really interested in stopping serious attackers. They're just trying to remind people that they really ought to pay something to read this stuff. So that's cross-site scripting. And many people say that it's 80% of websites have cross-site scripting vulnerabilities. It is not considered a high security vulnerability by most people because it does not mean they can get a shell on your server. They can't put files on your server, they can't steal your data, but one user can attack another user, and if you're clever enough, you can steal cookies and get in, so it can be used to do quite a bit of harm. Yeah?
So basically it's a low priority because it won't affect the person posting the website, just someone visiting.
Yes, I mean, it's kind of horrible, because the website's priority is not to protect customers from being attacked by other customers. Their main priority is to protect their own data. And so this is not as high a priority, and it's also very hard to stop. Every time you take data from anywhere, the login form, the reset page, the whatever page, you have to remember to scrub the HTML tags every time it comes in. And somewhere in your company, some developer didn't think of that, and they're just not motivated to spend the money to keep on scanning and plugging all these holes.
Can you protect your own browser from that?
You can put on NoScript. And NoScript will make you much safer, and it will also be very, very annoying. Typically you have to like approve 10 things for every page. Then you're much safer.
Yeah.
But this is the problem for the customers is the same as the problem for developers. It's very inconvenient to be secure, so you have to decide what level of risk. This is why I think Joanna Ruskowska is onto something. She has cubes, where you have like four virtual machines, and you have one that's red for like your banking, which is all locked down. The other one is like blue for your social networking where you make it convenient, and you just run them in different environments. That's one way to do it. Then if they do have a vulnerability, cross-site scripting, they can only get from one social network to the other. They can't get from your social network to your bank. So that's her plan. That's how you can protect yourself from rootkits. Anyway, so you've seen this one. See a few examples of common cross-site scripting attacks. And so you can steal somebody's cookie, then you can get in their session, you can target stored passwords from the browser. I saw a great demonstration of that recently, where you go to a page that just has one field, and when you click the button, it suddenly grows like a credit card field and everything else, fills in all this extra data that goes, and if your browser automatically fills things in, they'll go up there. And he said they fixed it so can't get credit card numbers anymore. You can get a lot of stuff like phone numbers and addresses and things. Anyway, I got to play with that and see if that's still happening. But cross-site scripting can do a lot of evil things. The WebGoat project, I used to have it in the projects here. We used this vulnerable thing called WebGoat. I switched to Security Shepherd, but they're both deliberately vulnerable web applications you can practice these attacks on. So if you have a web application, you want to see how secure it is, there are a lot of issues to consider. The connections to the database backend server, the authentication, and we got a whole class here, 129S in web application security now. We're going through this in great detail. But there's a lot of attacks, like I say, directory traversal is a common one where you use ./ to move up to other directories and go to some directory you're not supposed to be in. And it turns out to be a lot harder to stop these things than you would think. If you want to filter out ./, you can do that, but there are ways to encode characters like ./ and /, so they don't look like a ./ and /, but they're interpreted that way at the server. And IIS had a vulnerability we could sneak them through. If you try to filter out bad characters, this is like antivirus trying to detect known malware. That is just a challenge for the attacker. Find a way to mask their attack so you won't recognize it as evil. It's much safer to do whitelisting, where you only allow stuff that you know is good. And anything weird, you don't let it in. That's a lot safer than trying to think of all the bad stuff, because the bad guys have long hours in quiet little prison cells to think up endless ways to scramble the bad stuff and come up with a slightly altered version of bad stuff. Anyway, so a SQL injection is really fatal, and it's all over the place. If you want to see some live SQL injection, there's a minor issue that it's illegal, but if you don't worry about that for a moment, you go to pastebin.com, and the people just find them. You can run scanners and find tons of them, so you search for Squealy vulnerable websites. You can find them here by the thousands. Here's 10,000 fresh squealies from a year ago. So you go here, people run scanners, and they're not very interesting, so they just put them here. So here's ArtLink interiors. This is the way they almost all look. PHP ?ID equals one. This means it's a PHP script. It's going to take that ID and record it, and then it's going to do a SQL query to a database saying, look up the record with ID equal one. And if the programmer doesn't know what SQL injection is, then this will fetch the page, okay. And if you put an apostrophe there, you'll see a SQL error message, which I'm not sure if I'm getting here. Yep, there you are. You might not be able to read it. Let's see if I select error. You have an error in your SQL syntax. So this is the end of the world. This means I can take over their server, steal their data, erase everything, buy products for free, change the prices. Anything you want. You own their server. And by the way, this is technically illegal, what I just did. It's just a kind of crime that's so small that you can't really get prosecuted, because I now learned about their security vulnerability without their permission. But this has been posted publicly for more than a year. So one thing I have done to these people, I've contacted them to say, look, you're on this list of vulnerable websites that some other evil person put up there. But the point is, there should be nothing I can put in that breaks the syntax. The fact that I broke the syntax means I made it confused about what part of my statement was a command and what part was just data. And I shouldn't have the ability to send commands to the server, but I can. So let's go to one that we can mess with legally, and that's the one I set up for the purpose. Attack.samsclass.info, and you're doing this in the project, so you've seen this thing. Yeah, this one here. So you got a database, and I think you've done this in the projects by now. So this is what SQL queries look like. You select the fields from this database, and this is what real websites look like. You can put in a name and search for the name, and that's what it finds the name if it's there, and if it's not there, it doesn't find it. But if the programmer doesn't know what they're doing, they make the mistake of letting you put in a misunderstanding apostrophes. And so if you put in data with an apostrophe in it, you get a syntax error, and this should never happen. If you see a syntax error, the programmer has made a fatal error, because now I can do anything I want on the server. And here's the nastiest one to put up a PHP shell, but here's the one that Anonymous used to steal most of the database, and this is what one is used to steal most of the stolen data on the web by far, is this single attack where you put in a carefully selected data entry that includes a certain number of apostrophes, and that causes the server to misunderstand it so badly that it dumps out the data. And you can steal the credit cards from the server. Yeah?
Do
The syntax error message is the message that the command line will spit out to you, like the actual message, or like whatever interpreter they're using?
No, that's the error that the SQL server puts out when you have a malformed query. So, you know, if I go to one here, the program, if I go back to this raw one here, where I'm going to select all the data from SQL users. I do this, and it shows me the data from users. And that's what SQL is supposed to do. You want to see some records, you ask it to show you some records. If I put like an apostrophe in this, then I get the syntax error. That's just like when you were typing in a bash command and you make an extra mistake in your typo or C. That's what should happen. The programmer makes a mistake, they get told you have a syntax error, then they fix your code. But the user should not have the ability to create that problem. Only the programmer. That's the mistake. I'm able to do, down here, I'm just putting in a name. There should be nothing I can put in here that breaks the syntax. And a properly written code will not let that happen. And the solution is down here. See, this is how bad code is written. You just use, you have a where clause, where username like Q, and the Q came from the user. And you didn't really clean it in any big way. Real escape string is a very weak defense that will at least filter out the apostrophes. So the simplest kind of attack that uses apostrophes won't work anymore. But the proper defense is down here someplace. And it's in your projects. Yeah, here we are. Parameterized queries, which is in, I think, your extra credit projects. But this is the right way to do it. The right way to do it is to change the code to all this jazz with PDO connection. You need about 6 or 7 lines. And what this does is the query that came from the user, here's the request that came in from the user, which was their name, that is put in a data structure called uname. And that data structure is compared to the data in the username field. It is not made into a line of text with apostrophes where the SQL server tries to match up the apostrophes and parse it. That's what's a fatal error. When you make a line of code that has to be parsed in another language, you're asking for this. If you have data, you put it in a data structure that cannot be misunderstood as code structure, and you compare it at the other end. There's no way to hack into this. Or there's no way to do SQL injection in this. No one's ever found one. This is the perfect solution. And that's what they should teach students, but it's like 10 lines, and it's only one line to do it the wrong way, so it makes easier homework, and it's what you'll get an A for in class. And so that's why we're getting nowhere. When this was discovered by Rainforest Puppy 15 years ago, 11% of the web is vulnerable, and 11% of the web is still vulnerable. Every time you fix one, some new person graduates and puts up another vulnerable one. We're getting nowhere, which is true of a lot of security. Anyway, that's the game there. So you there's a lot of these. This one here is pretty funny. It was put up by Jeremy Hammond, who became the leader of LulzSec and went away for, I think, 20 years, 30 years in prison. But before that, he's a protester. He's a freegan, which is beyond a vegan. Not only is he vegan, but he lives only on food found in trash cans. In New York City, he has a political statement. And he also hacks everything and thinks everyone rich should have their money stolen and given to the poor. And he made this very good training site. Hack this site. It has a bunch of this training. I did a lot of this. I gave it to students for homework. I don't know if it's still in your extra credit projects. It might be. But anyway, in the brief intervals of time when he was out of prison, he made good hacking sites, but he keeps on, he wouldn't knock off this political hacking, and now he's locked away for a really long time. Anyway, Havij is the point-and-click tool to do this easily. This is how Anonymous did it. With Havij, you don't even have to know how to do SQL injection. You just run this tool. It's a free Windows tool. You click go, and off you go. It dumps all the data off the server. All it does is the same thing I just did with those long queries with apostrophes, but it does it for you automatically. And you use that one in the projects, I know, and then you can see that you can protect yourself from that by just filtering out the apostrophes. But there are more advanced forms of SQL injection where you really should use the parameterized queries. Anyway, so you connect to a backend server, and so you're going to check vulnerability scanners will just try putting a lot of punctuation marks in the field to see if any of those punctuation marks cause syntax errors or other errors. That's how you detect the vulnerability. And you have to authenticate your users typically, and you should watch how that happens. Are they really encrypting the password as it goes up? Are they encrypting the cookie as it goes up? The cookie should also have the HTTP only flag set. If you do that, they can't steal it with JavaScript because it's not in the document object model. It can only be used for HTTP requests, which makes it harder to steal from cross-site scripting. And so anyway, you can generate a platform. People usually do one of these things. There are Linux shops. They use Linux, Apache, MySQL, and PHP, or they're a Microsoft shop, and so they use IIS with ASP and SQL Server, and that tells you what kind of attacks to use. There's a different syntax for SQL injection on the different servers, but the general effect is the same. And like I say, on Pastebin, you can go here any day of the week and find thousands of vulnerable websites, and they're all just ready to be hacked, but they're ones that don't lead to a big treasure trove of money or anything, so nobody cares. So the bad guys will run scanners, find a bunch of them, pick out the banks, get the credit cards and sell them, and the junk they'll just dump on Pastebin. And if you want to entertain yourself, you can try warning these people. Good luck. I've did it for years. They can't understand. I mean, they don't know what you're talking about. If you send a message and say you're on this list and anybody can hack you, they say, this guy threatened to hack me. Lock him up is usually what you get. You can't help a fool. It's in the Bible somewhere. You know, a man who tries to educate a fool just gets stripes for his pain. You know, people have to have some clue or you can't educate them. So here's one of the many examples of some website with a SQL injection on it. This one here, by the way, is not a SQL injection. I misunderstood this, and Dan Kaminsky straightened me out. I put an apostrophe here, and notice what I got. It's not a syntax error. It said, the supplied argument is not a valid MySQL result resource. You notice that this is not an integer. It's the wrong data type. Now, that is an error, but that's not an exploitable error. It did not misunderstand the syntax, so I could not send up a command. It just had an error. Now, this is sort of a sloppy way to write a program, and it's unprofessional to let this kind of error message leak out to the customer, but it's not a SQL injection error. There was a U.S. senator that had one of these, and I thought he had a SQL injection, but it wasn't a SQL injection. It was just a normal crash that's harmless. This one was pretty entertaining. I heard about this on Twitter about 4 years ago. You can Google for URLs that contain select from in the URL. This is live SQL up there. That's how this shop works. It's Welding Supply Shop. You click on the product you want, and it puts the SQL right there. So this is SQL injection where you don't even have to inject it. You can just type commands up here, and they'll be executed on the server. This is the same as having like a DOS command prompt and a shoebox saying, buy what you want, please put money in the shoebox. You know, obviously the people that designed this don't know that. But, you know, I do not know how you could ever notify a person like this about this. I mean, they are so stupid and lost. I say, you know, take whatever grandchild made this website and send them off to military academy and hire someone to make a real website for you. I don't know. It's hard to think what you could possibly say to someone that is this lost. They just have no clue what they're doing. And here's local file inclusion. This is another glorious thing PHP brought us. What this is, see, it is very, very common for PHP websites, instead of having, my website, I don't do it this way. If you go to my website, you see I got samsclass.info, then I got 124 as a folder, this is a folder, that's a file name. So you refer to things by going through a tree-structured directory, and they're all just little HTML files sitting there. But there's another way to do it, where you make a PHP container, and the PHP has a parameter, which is what file to put in there. That's the other way to go, and a lot of websites work that way. So here, instead of just having a different page, they'll have index.php page equals. Now, page equals profile, page equals shopping, page equals blog. And if they don't filter it, you can use this page and refer to pages you're not supposed to see. And the traditional one you do is you go to etc/password, which shows the password file on the server, which does not contain passwords anymore. It contains usernames. But this is typically what you do. And you'll find these by the thousand on Pastebin too. And here's what they look like when you run them. Death star into page equals etc password. Here's like a system configuration file just right there instead of the web page. This is called local file inclusion, where I can put any file I want off the server in my page. So I can hunt around your server and look for goodies. And another one's even more fun is remote file inclusion, where you can put http://domain.com and put content from any site on the web in here. That one happens too. And then I can just put malware on the page. So I can put up a malicious server serving up an exploit. I can put the URL here. Now I can have a link that I email people. Click on this link. You'll be going to Death Star. You'll get infected, and you'll blame them. It's like cross-site scripting in that regard. I can modify the user's experience so a bad thing happens to them, and their browser will say, deathstar.net did that to you, and they'll end up hosed in the Google rankings and all that jazz. And I've covered my traces. Anyway, all right, so you find tools that will test the right thing. TGI scan is an old TGI scanning tool that will look for common vulnerabilities. That's one of them. On WebGoat, it worked pretty well. WebGoat was a vulnerable server I used in previous slides, and it found a whole lot of the problems on WebGoat. Wapiti is another tool you can use. WFetch is a tool from Microsoft that will test a lot of authentication methods on a server. In the web application class, I'm using the Zettack proxy, which is a product from OWASP. That's pretty nice. It'll scan a website in 10 or 15 minutes and find a lot of vulnerabilities. In general, there was a fun research project done a few years ago where a guy bought like the 10 most common vulnerability scanners and ran them against sites that had exactly what they were designed to find and found that they only find half the vulns they're supposed to find. These things are pretty miserable. I don't know if you remember, like 8 years ago, spyware scanners came out, like Ed Aware and T-Timer and stuff, and they you would run them on a website and you'd find all the spyware and remove it. Then you run the next tool and find a whole bunch more and remove it. They only got about half of it. And that's about how good vuln scanners are. They really only find about half the vulns because you have to have an intelligent human filling out the fields and clicking on things to really find all the problems. The vuln scanners are really stupid. They'll just try putting in like 10 different mixtures of punctuation marks in every field and see if they get something that they can recognize the error message, like syntax error or something, and then they'll say it's bad. But if they hit anything a little complicated, they aren't smart enough to get through it. So they only find some of the vulns. And W3AF is one that's really driven me nuts. It's included in Backtrack and Kali. It's free. And most of the time I run it, it just crashes and dies. But one semester I gave homework and inquiries, you will actually find a SQL injection in the page you made, but then if you modify anything, it just crashes and dies again. It's pretty fragile. Yeah?
How does it look for like a SQL injection? Just try to send a bunch of things to
it? It has a fixed series of things with like quotes and double quotes and slashes and stuff, and it sends it up, and then it looks in the response for something you can recognize, like that syntax message. If it finds one, these things have two problems. They have a lot of false positives. They will tell you there are vulns that are not real because they just don't understand the output, and they will also miss things. So, I mean, they're pretty unreliable. They're part of a pen test, part of a security audit. You should run a vuln scanner, but you have to manually verify what it finds because a lot of it is wrong. If you just hand the output of a vuln scanner to the client, they will hit your guts. And by the way, they encourage you to do this. They have like a beautiful print, beautiful PDF report feature. Makes it look good, as if you're going to hand that to your client. And if you do that, you're a fool. They should leave it ugly because it has to pass through an intelligent human before it reaches the client. Skipfish is Google's free vuln scanner, and it's actually not that great at finding vulns, but it's very good at finding all the pages because it's from Google. It's from their search, their crawler. So this will find every hidden page on the site, every hidden field and directory. It has great at that, of course. But it doesn't seem to have been developed in the last couple of years, but this one here is pretty good. I ran it on WebGoat and found like 49 SQL injections. And stuff like that, these red level vulns, yellow. And this is, of course, the main thing that Hay, a security expert for, is to sort them into. This is the most important, medium, not very important. That's what they need. They need a human to tell you, what could I do? I can't fix 100 problems. Tell me what three I really need to fix and which ones can I put off till next year. That's what they're paying you for. All right, so I got a few eye clickers about that. And that'll be the end. So what is this person trying to do? All right, I guess I'll quit at 30. All right. They're trying to do SQL injection because of the apostrophe. And by the way, this is the simplest and most common SQL injection. You put an apostrophe and then or 1 equals 1 and the dash dash starts a comment, so it terminates the line. So it, at the other end, it's like if email address equals the one in the database, and it's if it equals blank or 1 equals 1, so the condition is always true. So you can often put that in for the name and the password, and it will authenticate you as the first user in the database, which is typically the administrator. So this is the first thing anybody learns about SQL injection, is just that string right there. That is the simplest SQL injection attack. It doesn't always work, but when it works, it's very simple. Anyway, that's SQL injection. By the way, it doesn't always use the apostrophe, but the most common form uses apostrophes when you're putting in the string fields. With numeric fields, you don't even need the apostrophe. You just put in 1 or 1 equals 1.
And the password is just...
You could put the same thing in for the password or anything. Yeah, you try different things. And then if you do the capture the flags, there's a bunch of these and you learn more tricks. Often you have to do different things to start the comment, like slash star and stuff. After a while, you develop your favorites. All right. What's this person trying to do? Quit at 30. All right, that's cross-site scripting. They're trying to add script tags, which will be seen. This is very commonly the case with search engines. Because if I search for frog, the next page will say, pages found for frog. It will repeat what I put in. And if they don't filter it, the scripts will appear there. So that's a common place you find cross-site scripting vulnerabilities. All right. So what language looks like that there? All right, I'll quit at 30. All right, that's SQL, structured query language. All right. And SQL injection is not particularly because anything's wrong with SQL. Bash command injection lets you inject bash. There's command injection in every language. The problem is the customer should not be allowed to insert any commands at all. And every language has some syntax. And whatever they put in should just be data. It should not be commands. But in practice, SQL is one of the more common places where an error is made that makes it possible for the customer to inject commands. All right, what's being performed here? This really happened to 2600. Oh, it's a hacking magazine. They, of course, get hacked all the time. You're not listening? It's
sure,
listening.
Did mine die?
Oh, well, that's rude. All right.
No, wait, no.
Came back? All right. All right. Okay. All right. Well, let's see. That is, all right. And the best answer on this list is directory traversal. I would have thought also local file inclusion, but this is directory traversal, where you're wandering out of the directory you're supposed to be in and going somewhere else. That's one way to look at it. All right. Probably a better answer would be local file inclusion, but the real attack had like 100 of these slashes in a row, and I don't really know why you needed that many. So there was a little more to it than just simple LFI. But anyway, what's that?
Regex?
Something like that, yeah, yeah. I'm not quite sure, they somehow tricked it. That might be it, the regex didn't filter out enough. So what's happening here? Quit at 30. And that's local file inclusion. All right. By the way, I should mention about these pastebin things. I found on pastebin 100,000 vulnerable websites, all from the same Canadian developer, and I notified him, and he freaked out. There's a whole list. They go to my research section on WebSmart. He contacted the college to get me fired. He called me at home. He freaked out because I contacted some of his customers. He had 100,000 websites, all vulnerable. And he didn't want anybody to know you wanted to shut up and go away. And I didn't do that. And he published articles about what a rotten guy I was. It turned into a big foo-fa-raw. It's just telling people about their problems is something amateurs do in this business until you get over it. You know, it just doesn't do any good. If people have vulnerable websites, it usually means they don't have a clue and they don't want to hear it. And beginners like me often make the mistake of telling people until you get punished enough to realize it's just a mug's game. Tell people if they're paying you money. And if they're not paying you money, let them get hacked. That is the professional move.
All of them until you found the problem, right?
That's right. The point is this, I think, a problem with a lot of people that have, like, knowledge of, like, health risks or something. Like, this happened to the people in Pakistan, I think it was. They were trying to, I'm not sure, they were trying to inoculate people against something like polio. And they brought in the Red Cross, and the rumors went around that there was poison in the vaccine and that those people were spies. So they refused to get vaccinated. And then it turned out that the NSA really was sneaking, CIA was sneaking spies in with them. And they later on said, I got to apologize. I said, you know, now that you mention it, sneaking spies in with the health workers probably wasn't the smartest thing we could do. But anyway, they were spies, but the vaccine wasn't poison. But this happens, you know, there's people that just are so confused that when you try to help them, they punch the good guy. It's
Yeah, this is actually how they tracked Osama bin Laden. This is how they tracked Osama bin Laden from Pakistan.
Oh yeah.
Because there were spies who were saying that, oh, we are here to count children to get the polio vaccine.
That's right. So, you know, then the CIA keeps doing this. They call it blowback. They always do something which they know will lead to trouble later. But they only care about victory today, like arming Osama bin Laden. He used to be our friend. We armed him because they wanted him to kill some other guy. Then after a while, they say, gee, that wasn't so clever to arm this guy that hated our guts. But at the time, that was the way we achieve our immediate objective. And that's why people make all stupid websites, right? Today, we'll have the website up, and there'll be some security problem tomorrow, but I will have left by then. I'll have the money. So anyway. All right, so I think the tens and nines have it. So there's 37, 66, 67, and 21. And I ought to stop the recording. Should have stopped a little while ago. I got confused. 123, chapter 10b.